Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. A very warm welcome to you on this warm day in this wonderful town. We have a very exciting panel ahead of us today. It's called The Origins of Early Indians, although it might as well have been called The Origins of Indians. As we know, the question of our ancestors, the location of our civilizational greatness in the ancient period and its associated culture are issues that have that have concerned scholars for a very, very long time. Tony jumps right into those questions with his research, with his book, which is based on the latest research in genetics, and the results are fascinating. So without revealing too much, I'll just give you a few teasers. First, he tells us that all humankinds can trace their ancestry to a single African woman known as L3 and an African man known as CT. He tells us Europeans, or Europe was populated by modern humans for the first time after an episode of global warming. That perhaps Harappan should be seen as the real founders of civilization on the subcontinent. That we can tell the gender of migrants who left impacts on the population here on the subcontinent. That we might all be partly Ukrainian, partly Iranian, and perhaps he can tell us why that's both true and completely not true. That we can date the caste system, and this is what I liked most. He ends by saying that India is a multi-source civilization, and I think there'll be lots to discuss there. So actually, the speakers have all been introduced, so I'm just going to ask Tony to open with his remarks. We each have 10, 11 minutes to speak, and then we will open up the questions to the audience.
Thank you, Gitanjali, for that very wonderful introduction. And who we are and where we come from are topics that every human population has worried about, has thought about, and there are no human population groups in the world which hasn't figured out or worked out a mythology to account for where they come from and who they are. What has happened in the last few years is that because of significant advances in a new discipline called population genetics, as well as advances in other disciplines related to prehistory, we now have a far clearer understanding of how different population groups across the world came to be and what migrations led to their formation as they are today. As far as India is concerned, we now know, for example, that the Indian population is the result of four major prehistoric migrations that happened over thousands and thousands of years. The first migration was the out of Africa migration, the migrants who reached here in India around 65,000 years ago, that my book calls them the first Indians. The second migrations are related to Iranian agriculturists, especially in the Zagros mountain region of Iran, who were in the northwestern part of India at least by around 12,000 years ago, and who mixed with the first Indians and created the first agricultural revolution in that part of India, which later became the basis for the Harappan civilization. That's the second major migration. The third major migration happened from East Asia, when a group of people brought Austroasiatic languages. These are languages such as Khasi and Mundari, spoken by tribals in central India and eastern India, those languages are linked to the Mon Khmer family of languages today, spoken in Laos and Vietnam and Thailand. So this is the third class of migrations, and the third large migration. The fourth major and last major migration happened from the Central Asian steppe region, today known as Kazakhstan, who moved to South Asia and to India between 4,000 to 3,500 years ago. So these are the four major migrations that shape the Indian population. This is not something that we knew earlier, now we know. And the stunning part is that India, my book uses the word India in the old sense of the word, as in it includes all of South Asia. And today, if you take any population group in any part of South Asia, you will find this to be a combination of these four migrants. So essentially, we have created a common civilization out of multiple streams of migrations that happened in prehistory. This is a new understanding. But following from this understanding are very significant other consequences that follow, such as which completely changes the way we look at ourselves. For example, we have, it's a fact that today almost all population groups in South Asia, in India, no matter where in the caste hierarchy they are from, no matter what language they speak, no matter which region they inhabit, no matter what religion they are, almost all population groups in the country carry 50 to 65% of their ancestry from the first Indians who arrived here 65,000 years ago. That's a stunning new revelation, because we used to often ask earlier, where do we go to find the first Indians? Where are they? The answer today is that you have to look into the mirror. That's, we all carry the ancestry of the first Indians. And this has another implication. The rest of the population used to look at the tribals, for example, as someone very different from them. Today we know that the rest of the population in the Indian subcontinent, they have no closer relatives anywhere in the world than the tribals. We share the same ancestry. That's one. There are also other consequences that follow. For example, we now know that when the Indus Valley civilization or the Harappan civilization fell apart around 1900 BCE, almost 4,000 years ago, because of a long drought, we now know that the people, the Harappans, which is a mixture of first Indians and West Asians, they spread all over India. They spread into North India, they spread into South India. In that sense, the Harappans are the ancestors of all Indians. So in that sense, the heritage of Harappa, the genetic heritage of Harappa, the cultural heritage of Harappa, because when they moved, they took the practices, the lifestyle, all that they had perfected in the Harappan civilization, they took it with them. So they are the common ancestors of all of India, except that the linguistic heritage of the Harappan civilization today is in South India, because in Northern India, their language, which is likely to have been Dravidian, got overlaid, and there was a language shift that happened when the last migrants from Central Asia came between 4,000 to 3,500 years ago. So this is not something that we knew with this clarity earlier. Earlier, we used to think that the migration happened between 4,000 and 3,000 years ago. Now we know that it happened over a shorter period because of the latest research. That's between 4,000 and 3,500 years ago. So this is another dramatic new understanding of ourselves. But the most significant understanding, perhaps, could be that about caste. Before I arrive at what that finding is, please realize that by around 4,000 years ago, that is 2,000 BCE, around 2,000 BCE, all the four major components that we talked about, they're all in. The first Africans are in, the West Asians are in, the East Asians are in, the Central Asians are in. So all four components are in, and what geneticists say that what we see during the next 2,000 years, that is between 2000 BCE and the beginning of the Common Era, is a mixing of the kind that we have never seen before or later. And it is because of this mixing that happened for 2,000 years that we can today say that no matter which population group you take, no matter from how remote a population you take, you collect the DNA of a present, current-day human being, it will be a mixture. It's because of this mixture that happened for 2,000 years. But what happened in the beginning of the Common Era? Geneticists say that mixing stopped around that period because people started endogamy, the practice of endogamy, which is people marrying within their own community, started. And this, as you know, people marrying within their own community is the distinguishing feature of the caste system. So now we have, therefore, the answer to the question, roughly, when did the caste system begin? The answer is about 2,000 years ago. So that means the caste system didn't begin with the arrival of the Central Asian steppe people who brought Indo-European languages, who called themselves Arya. It began almost 2,000 years later. And by the time it began, people had already mixed. So it has two consequences. One, the caste system has no genetic reasoning behind it. It has no divine reasoning behind it either. So you have to look at the beginning of the caste system at the beginning of the common era as a political development that happened. And what exactly was that political development? How exactly did this vision of a society that is structured into four different classes, how did that come about, and how was it bought into by people all across this region? That's something that historians will have to answer later. So this, in summation, is what the results have told us. So I think it dramatically alters our understanding of ourselves, and I think it will take time for this to sink in, because many things that we had taken for granted as truth is no longer so. And yep.
Thank you so much, Tony, and thank you for sticking to the time limit too. Can I invite Keshavan Veritha?
Well, this question has been something which has worried students of history, particularly because I am one. I will take it up from the point of view of a student of history. And India started the tradition of looking at its own past, when Indians had this tradition of expressing historical consciousness. There was absolutely no idea about a migration, group migration from anywhere. All Indians were born and raised here. But in the 18th century, by the time we come to the 18th century, when the British established their political mastery over India, there was a need to study the language in which the law texts were written. And this gradually happened with the study of Sanskrit. When Sanskrit was studied by the colonial masters, they recognized this similarity between Sanskrit on the one side and the classical European languages on the other. So they said that, oh, this similarity goes beyond an accident. There is some structural similarity in the matter of verb, in the matter of roots, grammar, and other details. And therefore, they believed that Greek and Latin on the one side and Sanskrit on the other shared stem from a common root. When this recognition came, it was also suggested that since a language cannot exist without a people to speak it, the Indian people and the European people are descendants of a common racial stock. This was only at the level of a suggestion. In the 18th century, there was no discipline of linguistics. Archaeology had not developed at all, and anthropology was not a word which was known in the world. So, in a situation where none of these branches of knowledge existed, a racial theory based on linguistic evidence in relation to the most remote past was constructed. But this theory in the 19th century was extremely convenient to many people. By the time Max Muller, for example, in the 19th century used it, the equation that Aryan is equal to Sanskrit had already come to stay. Max Muller later was convinced that this is a wrong equation. Language and race cannot be equated. But then it was too late, because it had been accepted as a fact. And this fact was extremely convenient to many sections. For instance, the colonial masters found it very convenient to say that they and their subjects belonged to the same racial stock. The emerging middle class of India found it extremely convenient to say that, after all, we are being governed by our own people. So this colonial degradation the wounds which they were licking, that had an ointment with this idea of the Aryan race. Then, in the context of caste, this was very easily explained. Those who were here were conquered. So the conquered people were the lower caste. The conquering people were the upper caste. Those who came last were the best. Those who were the first were the worst. This was extremely useful again for a particular kind of politics which developed, for example, in Maharashtra, under the leadership of Jyotiba Phule, for example, the very highly anti-Brahmin. Now, I'm not saying this with any pejorative sense. The kind of caste politics had considerable use for this theory of the Aryan race. Again, in the matter of regionalism, now the Aryans came to North India. The North Indian people were driven south, and people in the south, therefore, were the people who had to suffer. So the kind of Dravidian politics which developed in South India in the 1920s and 1930s had considerable support from this theory when the Harappan civilization itself was discovered by the archaeologists. So rather than raising questions about the validity of the assumption of the Aryan race, the Aryan theory was accommodated, evidence from Harappan civilization was accommodated into it by saying that Harappan civilization was a pre-Aryan civilization, a non-Aryan civilization, and South Indians believed it was a super-Aryan civilization. So the Dravidian politics which developed, that also found considerable use this. And in Periyar EVR, for example, writing is Kimayanam, or Pallathiraman, in Malayalam writing is Ravanayanam, we can see rings of this politics. The discovery of Harappan civilization did not shake them. Instead, this was absorbed, the shock was absorbed into the cozy comforts in which they were living. All that was good and great about Indian civilization was ascribed to the Aryans. So it was the Aryan who is responsible for the great Indian civilization. This was extremely useful for a particular nationalism. This was extremely useful for the kind of mastery that the imperial masters were trying to seek here. And this had only one minor difficulty. That is, if everything that is good and great about Indian civilization is due to the Aryans who came from outside, that is somewhat uncomfortable, particularly for a politics which believes that those who come from outside are unacceptable. Now, you have to prove your citizenship status by saying that this is made in India, this is part of Make in India politics. Those who came from outside, no, that is not acceptable. So the Aryans must not be people who came from outside. Here was Bala Gangadhar Tilak, who writes his Arctic Home of the Vedas. You cannot say that he is not nationalist enough. But then those who followed Tilak started saying that, fine, the Arctic Aryans were from the Arctic region, but the Arctic was in India, in Bihar-Orissa region. North Pole was in Bihar-Orissa region. The Aryans stayed here, and the North Pole migrated. Now, I am quoting from M.S. Goldwalker's book, We or Our Nationhood Defined. Then we had also, it was only recently that the likes of Navaratna Rajaram tweaked a piece of evidence from Harappa to show a horse there. Now this, literally horseplay in Harappa was the result of this kind of a politics which wouldn't accept anything less than that is made in India. It should be from within India. Don't ask me uncomfortable questions like which India. Now, was there an India 4,000 years ago? I don't know. But don't ask me that question. But do you want to put the Aryans, those that are foundational to Indian civilization on a par with those horrible Muslims who came from outside and they were responsible for all that is bad? Do you want to put them on par with them? No, sorry, I am not available for that. This is the kind of politics that we are meeting. So, resort to what Navaratna Rajaram and others did and throw stones at Romila Thapar's and Shirin Ratnagar's. I do not know how many abusive letters and telephone calls Tony has already got for writing this book to show that we are all Indians, we are all migrants. This is the sum and substance of his argument. Now, if you ask me to summarize this book of Tony in two sentences, I'll say that we are all Indians, we are all migrants. But for saying that we are all migrants, I do not know how many emails did you get, how many abusive letters did you get, how many abusive telephone calls did you get? No, I'm very sure that he would have got many. If he hasn't, he must consider himself lucky, because people who must write such abusive letters aren't quite in the world of the literate tradition. Who would have read his book and understood this book? So this idea of trying to understand who the real early Aryans is, the kind of certainty that he has backed by evidence from genetics, which wouldn't have been possible 5 years ago. And it's a marvel that a five-year-old scientific discovery is taken up for such intelligent discussion. So that is where I consider myself lucky, grateful for being able to be part of this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think the politics of scholarship is something that's going to come up for debate later as well. Let me invite Sudha now to make her remarks.
Thank you, Gitanjali, and thank you, the panel. It's an honor to be part of this after Tony's very, very interesting book on what you said about that that all of us are migrants and puts us in a very comfortable position of being as diverse, as multivalent, as far spread as possible. And in spite of everything we do, we don't have one single source as people profess it to be, but then we have many, many points, and that's a very comforting thought. Taken from there, I'd like to talk about performance as the locus of my own presentation today. Performance in the sense of music, dance, and drama, of which Tony speaks about here and there. I'd like to take it as a kind of a transmission of a kind of knowledge that is very, very vital and very linked to human societies at large at any point of time. So to this extent, it is actually perhaps reflective of human life itself. And I want to, when I think of performing arts in India, dance, music, and drama, I'd like to take a couple of, maybe two or three icons that are very central to our imagination when we talk of Indian arts and Indian theater, Indian dance, drama. One, of course, is one what Tony himself has discussed in the Bhimbetka painting about two sets of people dancing together many, many thousands of years back. So that is indicative that there have been a very vibrant response to an aspect of life, perhaps joy. We don't know what exactly that was, but it's a kind of joyful abandon of two kinds of sets of people dancing together. So that is there in the Bhimbetka caves in the rocks. The second is actually the dancing girl again, which you have mentioned in your book. I don't know whether, I mean, he also worries whether it is a dancing girl or it's a girl, I mean, what it is. So it is a second, at the Harappan time, during that time, what happened. There's some kind of evidence, if we can call that, the dancing girl. The third, after quite a few centuries back, there is this, I mean, which, of course, Tony perhaps doesn't mention that, but it's a Shiva Nadaraja, the bronze that you find. I mean, they say it's about, I mean, that is also the Chola sculpture, that is an iconic representation of dance in that sense. I mean, taking these three points, I'd like to talk a little bit about the context and the patterns of change and the different things that shaped India's performing arts to one extent. One, of course, like I said earlier, these performing arts have a very vital connection to all areas of human activity. People dance when they were happy, when they were angry. I mean, the nomadic people, everybody sang and danced, and all that is part of our heritage in one sense. During the agricultural time, when during the times when agriculture became more pronounced, I mean, people danced for harvest, for example, after a good harvest, then for social occasions, for celebration of marriage, weddings, birth, all these were occasions in which humans danced with happiness and abandon in one sense, I mean, celebration, human bonding, perhaps, but also not just bonding, but also to record protest, for example, I mean, to record things that have not been so cohesive as cohesive forces in society. There have also been, ritual fightings, and then to express a society's or even individual's response to his or her environment. I mean, that also was one of the very major forces in kind of dancing or songs and recording, for example, subverting a situation. If there is something that has been sanctioned by society, but which you don't have, agree with to that, that's also one occasion which people objected, and then they showed that through dance and music. Also, it also gets expressed through, for example, cross-dressing, or you know, that kind of different, or even people fighting with each other, mock fighting. All these things also were part of society. And then, of course, the great martial dances across India, right from Tangta of Manipur to the Kerala martial dances. And so it is all over these patterns. I'm saying these not as a mosaic, but perhaps as shifting patterns in society expressed through performance. Then, of course, in agricultural societies, again, warding off diseases, appeasing the Mother Earth, all these were also different patterns that we have seen in performances in Teyam, in, for example, Lai Haroba from Manipur, in Chow, for example. All these patterns keep recurring. There are narratives, for example. The same narrative finds expression according to different class, caste, gender, across different groups and communities. And they say that the tellings change according to each and every region and community, even if it is a Mahabharata, Ramayana. According to who says it, how it is said, where it is said, the interpretation changes. So that oral epics also become very, very important at one point of time. And what is said is more important than how it is said in one sense. I mean, for example, some people may say that the gender perspective, Sita becomes a hero, where sometimes Ravan becomes a hero. It is not that there is one mainstream and there are versions of it. It's not like that. There are versions and versions of it. I mean, for example, the Mahabharata cannot be said in one as a kind of critical edition is so superfluous at this point of time, because, I mean, how many Mahabharatas can you think of? There are as many communities as there are Mahabharatas. At one point of time, also because of patronage and patronage changes, some changes occur in some aspects of performance, and they get more conventionalized, they become more codified, so we call it classical in one sense. Though I would like to say that classical is also one aspect of a collective folklore imagination. Nothing is made like that. It gets evolved, and it gets, you know, slowly fashioned according to the need and according to the taste of what at one point of time and one society. So everything to that extent, I'd like to ascribe that to social situations and people's tastes and also patronage, and so different points being important at different points of time. This also takes us to the contemporary relevance of theatre, dance and drama. Of course, any regression, any protest gets expressed in different kinds of, as we can see right now, even in contemporary India, the kind of spurts of, you know, different kinds of movements that have come, the songs, the dances. So actually what I'm trying to put is a very, very broad-based understanding of what we call as dance music and drama, not as, you know, anything that is classical or folk or sacrosanct, but as a very, very broad kind of imagination that runs through society and which charges society to multiple points and multiple uses. This is what. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think it's probably again something we can take up during discussion. Yeah. No, I will. No, don't worry. No, not at all. We have not forgotten about Pushkar at all. I was just going to say that I think there are, one of the interesting things is that there are actually different ways of understanding early Indians. And I think you've spent a lot of your career looking at memory in performance, especially very, you know, ancient or very old performance. And I think that's something that we would take up later as well, as different ways in which we could study early Indians. And I think Tony has brought genetics to that, but has also looked at some other, and look at how it speaks to linguistics and archaeology and so on. And now I invite Pushkar to make his remarks.
Good afternoon, and thank you to everyone for being here on this hot afternoon. Half the audience is in the sun, and I feel very sorry for that, but please accept my apologies. It would be very easy for me to wriggle out of everything after the author himself has spoken, and two good scholars have spoken about his work. But the book that's written, Early Indians, is so rich that you can really take off on a whole host of tangents. And one of the things I will explore today is the issue of language and genetics. Now, throughout the book, three different strands of evidence coming from three disciplines have been discussed. One is archaeology, the other is linguistics, and the third, which is the new discipline, is that of population genetics. We will leave aside archaeology for a minute and really talk about the problems of using linguistics and genetics together, not as have been done in this book, which is very clear they have been kept separate as far as their methods go. But historically, people have always mixed them up, thinking that linguistic categories, such as Dravidian, could be used for genetic population groups. Now, the reasons for this kind of mix-up are many, one of them being that languages, or the study of languages, linguistics, and genetics, or the study of populations, have similar kinds of phenomena. You have phenomena like drift, convergence, mutation in languages, as well as in the genome of the human population. And people have misunderstood these parallels as belonging to the same discipline. And that indeed is not true. Now, language, as Professor Veluthat said, actually gets appropriated for political purposes very early on, and hanging race onto it, hanging human physiology onto it, becomes a very distinctive sign of how the wrong cross-disciplinary approaches can cause enormous political damage. And it is in the 19th century that you have emergent ideas about what nations are, a new kind of state, the nation state, which is defined on the basis largely of what they call the national race and a national language. And the fact that these two come together in a package makes it very convenient to raise certain kinds of nations and also to lower certain kinds of nations as they imagine them. The whole of the Indian nation cannot be explained under one paradigm. And so a linguistic theory, which is largely accurate, but without solid proof at that time, that of a Dravidian language being overlaid and slowly being pushed south by an Indo-European language, which is slowly coming across North India and picking up elements of this Dravidian. This theory is used very cleverly to hierarchize society into a number of strata. So people that you like, you have affinity towards, suddenly become the civilized people of the correct language and race, whereas one language and race. Again, they are using it interchangeably. They're very different things. The other language and race, which is the Dravidian peoples, have to move lower down this hierarchy. Now, with Darwin, you have a problem for these people because they realize that languages mutate, drift, evolve, and change much faster than populations do, than species do. And there comes time to decouple language from genetics. And that too they do with great aplomb, using a number of different strategies in that case. I always like to think of, so when I read this book, I'm an architectural historian, and I've always argued for the primacy of visual and plastic data over textual data, but that's my personal bias. And that's because a text can be falsely written about, whereas something that's embodied in a building cannot be tampered with. And I think it's these two kinds of data, one which is embodied within the human body, and the other is which is extraneous, which is typically produced by people in power, that Tony has dealt with, where what is embodied within you is your own set of identification documents, your genetic makeup that nobody can really tamper with, which nobody can deny, which tell one kind of story. And the other story is one that is constructed in part by linguistics and also by archaeology, where there are multiple layers of interpretation that have to be sought. And so that is a story that's written by powerful people. The data might be right, it can be tweaked the wrong way, as we've been seeing in the past year or two, where absolutely solid genetic data also, once you have a layer of interpretation added onto it, can be spun the wrong way. But I think the genetics is the hard data. Like I said, it's like the construction of a building. The way stones are put together cannot be disputed. If a text says a palace that a king built has 40 rooms, but archaeology proves that there were only 10 rooms, there is no doubt as to which one is right. Again, things that are embodied outside the human body, as in systems of transmitting data outside the human body, have a chance of being false, whereas things that are embodied and encoded within the human body are absolutely undeniably right. And what Tony has done a fantastic job of is really putting both these systems together to create a very coherent study in which he has not made the mistake of falsely using linguistic data, labels, and identities onto a population study, but he supplemented all three disciplines with each other. So the integrity of the disciplines is kept true, but yet together they weave together to form a fantastic narrative. And again, this leads to an open question, which I don't have an answer for, is how do we start evaluating these forms of scholarship, particularly when our disciplines are completely determined and driven by the methods we use. So you might have the same object of study, but if an anthropologist looks at it, we say this is an anthropological method. If a historian looks at it, we say he's using a historical method. What do we do in a case where three methods from three disciplines are used in a very clever way, and I don't mean clever in a bad way, in a very clever way, to come up with a story that not a, you know, a single expert from disciplines cannot be relied upon to evaluate? What happens to processes of peer reviews in such cases? But this is for all of us to think about, so I'll hand it back to you.
Thank you so much, Pushkar. Perhaps the answer to that is we learn to work in teams, you know, both in terms of our research and also in terms of peer review. I don't know. I think this was a fascinating discussion. We've got a fair bit of time for questions. I think that, you know, in the spirit of Tony's book, there's a way in which you can approach the early Indian question and get all stressed about it because you have a particular agenda, a particular way you want to see it unfold and talked about. But there's also a way in which you can approach it with joy, with a sense of wonder, you know, with using your disciplinary training, trying to arrive at the closest answers that you, and the truest answers that you can possibly arrive at. And I think there's been snippets of all that in all of your work. So thank you very much. Let me open the question the question answer session, and then we'll get on to those of you in the audience. And I know there must be many, many questions there. Why are we so obsessed, do you think, with ancientness? Ancientness. So you were talking about this idea of the classical, and you were slightly unsettling the idea of the classical, right? Is this itself something of a colonial hangover? Is it time we sort of let go of this idea of ancientness? Why does so much of Indian identity have to do with ancient India? I think there are some obvious answers, and perhaps there's also some more can be said about it. Can I start with you?
Perhaps this has to do with the historiographical burden that we are carrying. In fact, when in the second half of the 19th century and early in the 20th century in India, as in other parts of the world where nationalism was developing, Greece, for example, the Balkan Peninsula, or other parts of the world where nationalism was developing, the appeal was always to history. And the older the history, the more attractive it is. So if your civilization is older than somebody else's civilization, yours is a greater civilization. So there was always an attempt to locate the greatness of Indian past or Greek past, the wonder that is, the glory that is Greece, or the grandeur that was Rome, or the wonder that was India, to the remote past. And this obsession with the remoteness of the past, the ancient that Gitanjali was talking about, this is ingrained in the nationalist ideology. Now, nationalism, as Renan says, is getting our history wrong. And it was absolutely necessary that history should be got wrong in order to construct manufactured images of the past. And these manufactured images of the past are more valuable the more old they are, the more distant they are in the past. So it is this obsession. This is number one. Number two is identity is always linked with origins. So the identity of the Indian is linked with the origin of the Indians. So the Indians, if they had their origin, so I'm not worried about people who came to India in the 15th century. I'm not worried about the Portuguese. I'm not worried about the British. But I'm worried about people who in prehistoric times came to India because they are foundational. And therefore, it is important to establish that there is an Indian root, an Indian origin to India. So this is the second aspect about this obsession with the classical, with the ancient, etc. So far as the historiographical burden is concerned, and it's extremely hard to shake off this burden. Unlearning is more difficult than learning.
I think you opened a very, very relevant question, and you also talked about memory. In that context, I'd like to talk about the topic that I have been studying for the last 10 or 15 or 20 years perhaps, which is Kudiyattam, the Sanskrit theatre, which is touted as the most ancient form of theatre anywhere in the world, and which has claims to have a kind of history of more than 2,000 years. And of course, I mean, these are the kind of things that we describe it, even to put it up to UNESCO as a masterpiece of great heritage and all that. So exactly what you talked about, I mean, the older you think, the more valuable or the more pricey or whatever that is. I mean, I think on second, I mean, now recent research has also proved that, I mean, what we claim in those claims are not perhaps grounded in history. You talked about hard evidence in that case. I mean, there are subsequent studies and researches have shown that whatever was, I mean, there was claimed was actually based on very, very scanned references here and there. There is no hard evidence of anything. And if at all something happens, it only happens after the 10th century. I mean, even that is also not on a very sure ground, but as it evolves, but then where do you start something which you don't have an evidence of about? You talked about hard evidence versus embodied evidence and textual evidence. So how do you date something specifically and saying that this is where something starts, especially something like a performance, which is not something that is concrete, that it can originate in 10th century or 11th century. It's also a process and not a product in that sense. So after many, many explorations, and now we are sort of trying to place it sometime around the 14th, 15th, 16th century, which is actually very shocking to people who have studied ancient, quote unquote, theater, ancient literatures. And so I think there's a lot of problem while you date, and I think I have no answers myself, but I think there are problems. This is much I can say.
I think an obsession with the ancient is really a product of all kinds of anxieties. I won't be able to pin down exactly what those are, but I think it's worrying that there are people with other sets of anxieties who are also obsessed with finding the ancient.
I just wanted to add one quotation from British historian E.J. Hobsbawm, which is builds on what Professor Veluthad said. He said, historians are to nationalists what poppy growers in Pakistan are to heroin addicts. We supply the raw material that the market wants. Essentially, history is often raw material, is the material that is used when there are contending definitions of nationalism. And I think history, prehistory, is a battleground today, because we do have a contending definitions of nationalism. We have a definition of nationalism that we have known since the freedom struggle began, which is inclusive, which takes along people of every religion, every caste, every region, every language, and which looks at the Taj Mahal as a symbol of our common heritage, as much as the Edakkal Caves, for example, which looks at Mahatma Gandhi as a hero for having brought everyone together. And we have a contending idea of nationalism, which has been around for 100 years, which has gained ascendancy in more recent times, which looks at the Taj Mahal as a symbol of shame rather than a common heritage, and which looks at Gandhi as a villain and Godse as a hero. And I think it is the contending nature of nationalism that we are seeing today, which is why prehistory is also a battleground, which is why it is even more important today that we base our understanding of our own prehistory on facts and not on myths. Thank you.
Okay, excellent. So, questions from the audience? Please keep your questions short and do introduce yourself as well.
Hello. Thank you so much, interesting discussion and so many new ideas what comes with the Tony Joseph's book. I want to start, I have two questions, short questions. First, I want to start with Professor Kesavan. You briefed what kind of politics did the earlier narrations of the history. Narration formed by the colonials, that has one kind of politics, and a narration formed by the nationalists, that has another kind of politics. And do you see what kind of politics this narration formed by Joseph is doing now, or what kind of politics it may do? And I want to add another question to Joseph. And I'm so much thankful for his new narration of the Indian history. That one thing I want to ask is this obligation to the identity is important per the person who develops the narration. Obligation to the identity is important for the writer or who forms the narration. That means who is forming the narration and why he is forming narration. So what you see, your obligation to any kind of or your kind of identity is important or is played any role to form this narration, what you formed through this book. Thank you.
Shall I begin? Thank you for that question. No, I'm very, very convinced that a politically neutral history or any politically neutral knowledge is not possible. All knowledge is politically loaded. This is the very, very firm conviction that I have. Having said that, I also believe that when particular branches of knowledge are politically abused, and the abuse claims that I have the support of true knowledge, it is the responsibility, it is the bounden duty of a serious scholar in that discipline. I, being a student of history, I believe that the political abuse of history has to be opposed. When political abuse of history is being opposed, it means that I am taking the side of a politics which is on the other side of the barricade. So, when you ask this question, what is the politics of this? I think this answers the question. This is the politics on the other side of the barricade. Is that?
I have two answers. One, people often ask me, where do I get my DNA test done after reading my book? The fact is that I have not got my DNA test done. I have no particular desire to know where I belong and what that ancestry is. And I don't think it should matter. Second thing is that when I began on this book, I did not know what the answers would be. I've gone merely, entirely by where the research took me, where the research findings, research papers, all of which are mentioned in the book, which you can go and read for yourself. I have gone entirely by what the findings say. And many of those findings go against established narratives. For example, the fact that the Harappans are common ancestors, genetically and culturally, apart from linguistically not, but genetically and culturally, that they are the common ancestors of North India and South India, goes against many earlier narratives. The fact that almost all population groups carry the 50 to 65% of their ancestry from the origin goes against many narratives. It's a highly uplifting, unifying message. So I have gone purely by where the research findings are without regard to what those findings mean for any of the existing narratives. And those researches are mentioned, each of them, by research papers are mentioned by name, and you can easily find them. They're all accessible.
Please introduce yourself.
Yeah, my question is to Mr. Tony. This genetic thing, isn't it, as far as the ancestry is concerned, isn't it still a kind of work in progress now? Because now I was reading somewhere, there is this skeleton they found in a place called Rakhigarhi. I don't know if you included this in your book. Okay. And there are two opinions about that. Some say that it is evidence for migration. Some say there is no evidence for it and things like that. So what do you think about this genetics? I mean, as I said, it's a work in progress. It's a very recent development, isn't it?
There is a new studies clearly confirm Arya migration is my piece in the Hindu that appeared after the two new reports came out. It's about in September. Please see that, which has the full details of the two new reports that have come. Please read the reports themselves. Do not go by what newspapers report as having this scientist said or that scientist said. If you go purely by what the reports say, there is zero confusion, zero. The reports that you can see for yourself. And my report in the Hindu actually quotes these two studies. So if you do not want to go into the reports themselves, please read this piece. Vasant Shinde. That's what I said. He contradicts the paper that he wrote himself. And you don't have to take my word for it. Read the research paper. Actual research paper which is available.
Okay, I just read this about
and
this.
And if you can't, at least read my paper which quotes from the research paper.
Thank you.
These are areas of fundamental. These issues are fundamental to a certain view of Indian nationalism which views Sanskrit Vedic Arya culture as the foundational and only source of Indian culture. What the findings now say is that the Sanskrit Vedic Arya culture is an important part, it's an important part of Indian culture, but it is neither the foundational one nor the earliest one that belongs to the Harappan civilization, which is pre-Arya. So that there would be significant attempts to distort what the papers say is not a surprise. This is to be expected. And has always been the case. So the answer to that is read the paper. Don't go by what the reports say. Don't go by what this guy said, that guy said. Read the paper. That's why the paper is there.
Are there any more questions? Well, actually, I had one more small comment for the two of you, just a small question. So, you know, you talked about origins and hard evidence and how to think about origins. And again, I wonder if you both could respond to this, is whether, in fact, part of the trouble with this ancientness thing is also our trouble with this obsession with finding origins of things. And while for Tony's story, it is actually possible to locate in certain scientific ways the origins of of DNA and things like that, it's not always possible to find the origins of many things. And so, in fact, to perhaps the other associated problem with this is the problem of the definitive answer. Must we have origins always clearly laid out? Must we always have definitive answers? And I'm just wondering if both of you could sort of respond.
So, this whole idea that you should look for the Ur moment for everything, you should look at a point of origin, is already an old idea. I mean, a lot of people have moved past that. What we are interested is processes through which things happen, not so much where it began, because that doesn't always help us in any meaningful way. And
I agree with you. I agree with Pushkar that there is no need to, that it's absolutely the processes that matter rather than what something that we conjecture may or may not as something that happened at one point of time. And that is, I think, totally, and it may be refuted the next day with some other evidence. So more than that, I think it's more important is to find what it is at certain point of time and how it evolved. I think that process is more interesting, at least in performance studies, is what I feel.
And in any case, finding the origin or the pure moment of everything, purity is a complete fetish that scholars have indulged in. Nothing in the world is pure. There are moments which we consider high moments, and we tend to fetishize them. Those are moments of power. Those are, moments that are significant for a lot of reasons, but there's no reason to hearken back to those moments and say that's where we want to be.
So let us go beyond notions of original sin.
Is there one last question? Are we done?
Thank you so much.